Chirac. I love you, yes I do. And there's one thing, baby, that I gotta say to you.
When I was 13, I remember slashing my own hand open and, you know, writing Blues Forever in my own blood.
I'm gonna say how it's gonna be. You're gonna give your love to me.
It was honest music, you know, and it was, it had emotion.
Sweet little baby, say what you will. Your tongue wags so much when I send you to hell.
The only music that appealed to me at all was black rhythm and blues.
In the 1960s, the raw sounds of authentic American blues inspired a host of young British musicians, bored with the pop music of the day. Bands like the Rolling Stones, the Animals, and the Yardbirds built upon the bedrock of the blues, leading directly to the high-energy music of Cream, Jimi Hendrix, and Led Zeppelin, sending rock and roll in powerful new directions. At the turn of the century, the blues was played mostly by and for blacks living in the American South.
I went to the crossroads.
But when thousands of blacks migrated north in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s, they brought the blues with them. By the mid-50s, Chicago had become the mecca for black urban blues, a sound that was largely ignored by rock and roll dominated white America. But soon the blues would find a new home, 4,000 miles away.
I heard John Lee Hooker singing things like, I've been working in a steel mill, trucking steel like a slave all day, you know. And I woke up this morning and my baby's gone away, you know. And I related to that directly because that was happening to people, to grown men on my block.
By the early 1960s, black bluesmen were beginning to venture across the Atlantic.
I was gone from the first time I heard Muddy Waters' guitar. I heard him rehearsing in the City Hall in Newcastle on a summer's night. The doors were open, and I could hear this electric guitar echoing across the city center, and I go, whoa, what is that?
By 1962, Burden was playing rhythm and blues with the Animals in the Newcastle club scene. They soon became the area's leading band.
And there's one thing, baby, that I gotta say to you. You know, I love you, baby. I'll keep you satisfied.
Our first gig would be go on stage about 8 o'clock on a Saturday night. We'd finish that place at 11 o'clock, drive across by then to the downbeat and play there till 5 in the morning. On a Saturday alone, we'd have 7 hours on stage in front of an audience, not sitting in your bedroom practicing.
Yeah, it was a genuine underground. And it was amazing to find out that what we were doing in Newcastle, which we thought was strictly our thing, was being done at the same time in other cities by other people.
Belfast in Northern Ireland was also seeing an explosion of bands, inspired by the American blues records brought in by merchant seamen. The rich jazz and blues collection acquired by shipyard worker George Morrison fascinated his young son, George Ivan.
Well, John Lee Hooker says it's the truth. That's what I believe. Blues is the truth. Because it's not, you can't glamorize it. You know? It just is what it is. You know, some days are good and some days are bad, and this is reality.
Morrison began performing at the age of 14. His group then moved to the forefront of rhythm and blues in Ireland and gained a following at Belfast's Maritime Hotel.
It was very slow when it started. There weren't that many people to begin with, but it gradually sort of built up. And so when that took off, then it became, you know, more acceptable.
In the sleepy confines of London's white middle-class suburbs, the compelling sounds of rhythm and blues captured the imagination of students at local art colleges. But the records were hard to find.
You couldn't buy blues records then. There were Josh White records and semi-blues sort of things, but they were unobtainable. You never heard them on the radio, you never could buy a record of blues anywhere. They had to be imported. So you heard about people that had a Muddy Waters album and you borrowed it off them or had a tape made of it. And there was a kind of underground that's how it got to people.
When Chicago's Chess Records found a new British distributor through the Pye label, material from Muddy Waters, Sonny Boy Williamson, Willie Dixon, Elmore James, and Howlin' Wolf became widely available and successful throughout the UK, much to the surprise of the label's owners.
We had Howlin' Wolf even on the charts. Smokestack Lightning was on the white charts. And Pye became a very hot record company, one of the new English record companies, and we sort of rode along with it. The English discovered Chess, really. The real fanatics always knew it, but the mainstream English music lovers discovered it.
The growing interest in rhythm and blues encouraged musicians to set up clubs devoted entirely to blues music. At the forefront were Cyril Davis and Alexis Corner.
We wanted to play electric music, and then we were in trouble, because the only clubs that we'd played, apart from our own when we were playing acoustic, were jazz clubs. Then when we went electric, it really was a case of out, and don't you dare set foot in here again with all that electricity. So we had to start our own club. And there was a strange assortment of people working around then, all of whom wanted to get into the blues thing. Charlie Watts and Mick Jagger and Paul Jones.
Alexis Corner's shows at the Ealing Club made it the most important blues venue in Britain, attracting musicians from all over the country.
It showed me that it was definitely worthwhile considering moving to London and, you know, transferring my day job in art, graphic design. So I started recruiting guys under the name of John Mayall and the Blues Breakers. And Alexis Corner was the one who really introduced me to musicians who were around at that time.
It was a kind of a magical gathering of people that had fallen in love with his vibe, and be standing there shoulder to shoulder with Keith Richard and Mick and those guys, and we'd stand in line waiting for Alexis to say, okay, you can come out, you know, you're next, and why don't you two sing together? And, so he was like the grand master of ceremonies, and it was fun.
When Corner set up the Ealing Club, Britain was riding the first wave of Beatlemania. But to blues enthusiasts, the Liverpool sound was just lightweight pop compared to their own more challenging music.